a shelter scripture like the Bible doesn't have. We make ourselves available for the same benefits of having Krishna present before us, just like Arjuna did. Like we lose someone very dear to us. We'll see people come together and talk about this person, remember the wonderful things in their lives, and so on, and become enlightened. So what to speak of coming together and hearing about Krishna's wonderful pastimes, coming to visit his temples, coming to worship the deities, offer flowers to the deities, pray before the deities. But we thank you very much for coming. We hope that you can make this a regular visit. We'll stop here. If there are any comments or questions, Ms. Ventura?
Yes. I noticed that the last those words that were mentioned in this shloka is loha and krodha. And Srila Prabhupada very much mentions in his lectures and in the books how the jiva has to come to actually reawaken prema for Krishna and return back to the boat of Krishna, the sattvic life, sattva guna. And these qualities, which I believe we will see in a society so pronounced now, of this anger, greed, as go on interstate, drive for a few hours, or figure that out quickly. People are not cooperating in like the sattvic idea of letting you serve. Sattvic means service, right? And the lower ones mean selfishness and conflict and wrong competition. So, yeah, well, so, our founder Acharya has given us directives how to live a sattvic life through his Vaisada Bhakti, along coming down to our Acharyas, of course, and to create a more favorable environment for us to progress, actually, and not struggle so much, mostly in our own behaviors, of course, correcting our own behaviors, trying to be like that. I don't know if you want to comment. I had a couple of things I want to talk about, but it's hard for to kind of collect it all. But if you want to comment, I don't know about the subject of life.
Do you have any comments on your point? Of krodha and kama and loba, greed, anger, lust, how we can counteract in spite of it.
Actually, I have a question I want to ask you. Toward the beginning of your class, you quoted this verse from the Bhagavad Gita, which says, demigods, being pleased by sacrifice, will also please you. Unless my cooperation between men and demigods, prosperity will be for all. And I just want to make a comment and then a question. I just want to comment, I just in the third part, Prabhupada said something very interesting which I never realized. He said that the demigods supply the air, light, and water, and all the benedictions for maintaining the body and soul of every living being. Entrusted to the demigods, who are innumerable assistants in different parts of the body of the Supreme Person of God. Mm-hmm. This one's very interesting, that Indra, Surya, Varuna, all demigods are in the body of the Supreme Person of God. So my question is that sometimes we hear, like, let's say it gets really cold and rainy and drizzly outside, and we say, oh boy, the weather's affecting my mood. Well, I'm just wondering, does the collective mood of humanity, like we hear about weather affecting our mood individually, does the collective mood of humanity affect the weather?
Does the collective mood of humanity affect horse-fed diet, and I get certain reactions in my body. So if the collective diet of humanity is the killing of animals, naturally the collective body will suffer. Everything's to Native Americans and all our relations, everything's related. Pay our respects they are due, please, the demigods who are in control of these different departments, environmental affairs, then naturally there will be some disturbances. I mean, simple activities become disturbances. Actually, just the other day I caught a little clip on the news. I didn't read the details of it. One of the candidates, Democratic candidate, Marianne Williamson, made a comment that something to do with the course of the Hurricane Dorian could change with prayer. And she deleted it. Obviously, it was the masses generally can't accept, can't go that far in her faith. I mean, at least publicly they won't. But she was making that point that by prayer, and we had that experience here in River Island. Some days back when here in Nevada, went to Cincinnati, there was a drought for I don't know how long.
6 months.
And then he was encouraging the people on the radio to chant. And people chanted. And the announcer was asking the people to chant. And they were calling back and saying he was chanting. And then next thing you know, some clouds come rolling in. And there was some rain. It hadn't rained in a long time. So Krishna came to show how it is. And then in Sri Prabhupada had an experience in India also. They went to one place where there was a drought for a long, long period of time. He encouraged the devotees to go out. And they went and chanted, and there was rain. And then the story of Maharaj Yudhisthira. When Maharaj Yudhisthira was offered some land by Duryodhana and company, they were offered land that was just horrible. And but by their sacrifice, by the performance of sacrifices, this is the key element. To sacrifice, what does that mean? Word mean? To make sacred, to connect. So whatever we do, whatever we offer, whatever charities we perform, whatever austerities, we do it for the pleasure of Krishna. Of course, by doing it for Krishna's pleasure, automatically the demigods, they'll be satisfied. We don't go independently and directly to satisfy the demigods. That's not our main business. Is to go to the source. And of course, in this day and age, the recommended sacrifice is what? What is the recommended sacrifice? Chanting. Chanting the holy name is so easy. Simple, not easy. Not necessarily easy. A lot of things get